And in explaining why he launched this invasion, President Putin falsely claimed that Ukraine was always a part of Russia. And just as he did the first time he invaded Ukraine, Putin made bogus assertions about pro-Russian Ukrainians being under threat. To help sort fact from fiction and get a better understanding of how we got to this point, the NewsHour's Ali Rogin looks at the history of Ukraine and of its people's political independence.
In 1991, at the beginning of the end of the Soviet Union, Ukraine declared independence after nearly 70 years under Moscow's control. And when Russian President Vladimir Putin took power a decade later, he began trying to get it back. Ukraine, he says, is part of Russia's family.
We will believe that Ukraine is not only our closest neighbor, but is indeed our brotherly republic.
At a NATO summit in 2008, he reportedly told then-President George W. Bush that Ukraine was not even a country. And he repeated those claims last week before launching the invasion.
Ukraine never had a tradition of genuine statehood. Modern Ukraine was entirely created by Russia.
That claim ignores the centuries of history through which modern Ukraine took shape. It was first home to the Kievan Rus people, who were Scandinavian traders and Russia's namesake. Over time, it was absorbed by Poland and Lithuania, and then the Russian Empire and Austria-Hungary. A post-World War I treaty briefly recognized its independence, long enough to spark Ukrainian nationalist movements. The Ukrainian Socialist Soviet Republic was born in 1922. Under Soviet rule, Ukrainian identity was under constant threat. In 1932, Soviet leader Joseph Stalin deliberately imposed famine there, killing at least 3 million Ukrainians in a single year. Indeed, by World War II, some Ukrainians welcomed Nazi occupation as a way to challenge Soviet control. But the Nazis slaughtered more than 1.5 million Ukrainian Jews. Millions more non-Jewish Ukrainians were also killed or put to hard labor. By 1954, the country that exists today was part of the USSR. The final piece was Crimea, a peninsula on the Black Sea, which Soviet leader Nikita Khrushchev transferred from Russia to Ukraine. But even after Ukraine declared independence in 1991, pro-Russian political elements remained, which Putin exploited. In Ukraine's 2004 presidential elections, he supported the pro-Russian Prime Minister Viktor Yanukovych. Yanukovych ran against Viktor Yushchenko, a pro-Western opposition politician.
It would be a great mistake if Ukraine misses a train bound for Europe.
Yanukovych won, but international monitors said the election fell short of its standard. Yushchenko's supporters took to the streets. They sparked the Orange Revolution, so called for the campaign's colors, holding protests and storming parliament. The Ukrainian Supreme Court deemed the results invalid, and Yushchenko won the next election. During the election, Yushchenko became ill, and his face became disfigured. It was found to be dioxin poisoning. His supporters blamed the pro-Russian government.
Who is responsible? The Ukrainian authorities are, who have been doing everything not to let Yushchenko win.
He did win, though, and continued pushing west.
The political goal is the final integration to the European Union and NATO. The main question is not in the direction of movement, but in the speed of it.
But in eastern Ukraine, support for Russia remained strong. In 2010, Yanukovych ran again and won.
My task is to make sure that Russia-Ukraine relations take a radical turn in the right direction.
One of those radical turns came in 2013. Yanukovych stopped trade talks with the EU, instead pursuing a similar agreement with Russia. Ukraina, це Європа. That night, crowds gathered in Kyiv's Maidan, or Independence Square, which continued to grow into a sprawling camp.
We are ready for war, but we're hoping for the best. A government should be afraid of the people, not the people afraid of the government.
But the head of the Russian government vilified the Ukrainian people.
In my view, this is an attempt by the opposition to shake the current, and I want to emphasize legitimate authorities in the country.
As 2014 began, authorities grew more violent. In late February, Ukrainian security forces shot and killed dozens. Then the opposition and government reached a truce, and Yanukovych fled, reappearing a few days later in Russia.
I intend to keep fighting for the future of Ukraine against those who are using fear and terror to seize the country.
But the one trying to seize Ukraine was Putin. He sent unidentified armed men to occupy airports in Crimea, which Putin has long said was stolen from Russia. Putin denied sending in troops, but said he would if asked, setting up a pretext just as he did for this invasion.
What can be a reason to use the armed forces? This is, of course, the last resort, simply the last resort. If we see that lawlessness starting in eastern regions too, if people ask us for help, we reserve the right to use all options at our disposal to protect those citizens.
Those so-called requests for help soon followed. On March 6th, the Crimean parliament voted to secede from Ukraine and join Russia. Days later, a public referendum, rife with alleged fraud, passed with 95.5% of the vote. That July, the U.S., EU, Canada, and other allies imposed sanctions on Russia. More unidentified vehicles arrived in Crimea, escorted by Russian police cars. And Russian troops took over more buildings. As it is today, the Putin regime said it was helping Crimeans defend themselves, with little evidence they needed defending.
Will Russia be able to remain indifferent to the situation when, in neighboring Ukraine, Russians are facing a deadly threat? The answer is simple. No, Russia cannot remain indifferent, and it will not remain indifferent.
2 months later, Ukraine elected its next president, pro-European businessman Petro Poroshenko.
We should do everything possible to bring European values to Ukraine.
But the events in Crimea had inspired pro-Russian separatists in two other regions, Donetsk and Luhansk, collectively known as the Donbass.
We want to have an independent Republic of Donetsk. We want to be independent from Ukraine.
The political protests took on a military dimension. Russian-backed separatists began an insurgency against the Ukrainian military. There were diplomatic attempts to reach a ceasefire, but those never held. The fighting continued into 2019 when Poroshenko lost re-election to TV star and neophyte politician Volodymyr Zelensky, who'd once played and accidentally elected president of Ukraine. He campaigned on domestic issues, but also wanted to restore peace to the Donbass.
Most likely, if I meet Mr. Vladimir Putin, I will tell him the following. Well, you finally gave us back our territories. How much money are you ready to give as compensation for the fact that you took our territories and that you assisted people who participated in escalation in Crimea, Donbass, and assisted them on the awful, cruel, and disgusting path?
3 years later, Putin is forcing the Ukrainian people further down that cruel path while Zelensky fights to lead them out. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Ali Rogin.
What a helpful look at the history of that country.